Villanova on top of the Big East. That is the storyline through a third of conference play. The Wildcats have reasserted themselves after starting the season 2-2. They have proceeded to win 13 of 15 because they have A-type playmakers who have developed. Eric Paschal and Phil Booth are combining to average nearly 43 points per game. Booth averaging 5 assists per game in conference play. And look at that. How do you defend that? How do you stop the Cats? In the Big East thus far, you don't. They win at Hinkle Fieldhouse earlier this week. A dunk party crashed the Cintas Center last night, courtesy of Ed Cooley's Providence Friars. Mekhi Ashton Langford with a one-hand jam. Ed Cooley and Providence, they were 0-7 at the Cintas Center all time. They needed to change that last night to get themselves in the picture. Another jam, and the Friars win at Cintas. There is a basketball resurgence in Milwaukee, and it has everybody pumped. Marquette is perfect at home. Theo Johns developed into the best shot blocker in the Big East Conference, and that was on display last night. 6 rejections. There's 2 in one play. Marquette wins. They beat DePaul, and they are on the pursuit. Golden Eagles chasing down the Cats. Then it is chaos. Total chaos. Everybody in the Big East has an over 500 record overall. That's the only conference in America that can say that. But think about this. 16 of the 33 games have been decided by 16 points or less. It is just chaos. From 3 to 10, you've got 5 teams all evened up at 3-4. Folks, they can't hire the person doing the tiebreakers for enough money, because that is going to be one complicated tiebreaker to figure out as we welcome you to Big East Shootaround. I'm John Fanta. Great to have you with us from New York City. How about Villanova? Nova gonna Nova. That is what they've done thus far in conference play, and we just told you about Marquette. But coming up on today's show, we'll go all the way out to Los Angeles to try to figure out the Big East. Steve Lavin will join us from the Fox Sports studio. Creighton's Ty-Shon Alexander about to lead us off, and we'll take your questions as well. Somebody asked me, what's your favorite day of the Big East tournament? I have to pick one? If I had to, I'd pick semifinal Friday. There's nothing like that doubleheader at MSG. You really have the top 4 in the conference going at it. And Creighton's done that a couple of times thus far. In the first year of the conference, they made it all the way in the title game. But this Creighton team retooling. Ty-Shon Alexander is the bright spot. Single point per game scorer last year, and you had Marcus Foster and Kyrie Thomas, so he was just a freshman. This season, 17.5 points per game, coming off a big night in D.C., and now he gets to come home with his Blue Jays. They may only have 2 conference wins, but folks, only one win separates 3-10 from this conference. Now the Jays are getting back home. They're one tough out in Omaha, and we got the perspective from Creighton sophomore Ty-Shon Alexander. Ty-Shon Alexander has been charging the Creighton Blue Jays all season long, and he did it again earlier this week in Monday's win over Georgetown, a 26-point performance for the sophomore. He's with us now on Shootaround. Ty-Shon, what do you attribute that performance to offensively? What were you able to get working for your game?
Pretty much it was attacking the paint and try to sit there and create as much as possible for my teammates. My teammates did an excellent job going in, setting their feet, doing everything right for us to get this win, spraying it out. And in some occasions, I was just open, got my shot going at the end, and it just felt good sitting there playing at their arena as well.
You have really taken that step of growth throughout the offseason. What exactly did you work on throughout the offseason to become the A-type playmaker for this Blue Jays team?
Pretty much, I worked a lot with my ball handling and getting a lot of shots in as much as possible. We have this system here that's called the NOAA system, and I used it a lot to sit down and work on my arc and also my depth of my shot. And it's helped a lot during the summer, just coming in here days and nights, even having maybe 2 days or 3 days to sit down and just get extra work in to prepare myself for this year.
At this point, your team now 2-4 in Big East play, and you get to come back home to Omaha to take on Butler on Friday night. What would you say the thing is that Coach Mack is stressing in practice that this Creighton team needs to continue to get better with for you guys to make a run?
Our toughness was a lot better coming in. We got a lot of complaints saying that we were a soft team. Some days that we actually didn't have that our shot wouldn't be falling. Coach Mack really pushed us our hardest to come in, be a lot tougher, do drills to make us more physical. And it helped us a lot coming in the Georgetown game and coming in for the Butler game. And obviously it's a big game for us because we lost at their place. We got out toughened, so we have to come in and be the tougher team.
All right. Is it cold enough out there for you?
It's freezing. It's so cold. When we got back during Georgetown and it was snowing and it was just like 2 degrees around like 2 o'clock. So it was just wind and getting off the plane. It was rough.
You think Coach Mack's a good shoveler?
I hope he is. I mean,
he better be.
I don't know what he does, but hey.
You think he's got somebody who snow blows his driveway, or you think he's out there?
I don't think Coach Mack is doing that. He's, matter of fact, I wouldn't mind seeing him going out there shoveling some snow off. It would be nice to see that.
It would be nice for him to do that. We got a couple of fan questions here. And the first question is, best meal prepared by the Bluejays, whether it's a delivery place or whatever it is postgame? And for those who don't know, the Bluejays are the Creighton managers.
Yep. You want to know about before our game or like just like after practice and stuff?
Yeah, either way. What's their best move?
Pretty much before our games, I pretty much eat like a salad, Italian salad, some noodle, like some pasta or whatnot, and salmon. I really love salmon. So that's pretty much my pregame meal every time. And also a glass of lemonade and a lot of water.
We got another fan question. Someone asked, how big of a role does your uncle take in your life?
It's crazy because this is actually my uncle that asked me this question. But he calls me either before or after every game to sit there and tell me like things I need to work on, things I did good at, but also what I could do better at. My uncle does a fantastic job reaching out to me, watching the games, and just pretty much just telling me like what all I need to do to sit there and get better, how I need to sit there and do these type of things, and it's a big thing for me.
Where does he live?
He lives in Charlotte.
Does he ever come out and see you?
He's been to two of the games. He might end up coming to another sometime soon.
That's tremendous to have that relationship with him. Our final fan question is a little bit lighter, and I'm curious to know, John McHugh chiming in and asking you, has he ever won a game of dominoes?
I won one game of dominoes, and it was this year. Last year, I always came in third and fourth place, and it was rough. We actually played dominoes with John's girlfriend's family, and it's fun just being out there, hanging with them, and also interacting them just by playing a friendly sort of type of game with dominoes.
Is there a best player on the team? Like, do your teammates play?
Yeah, Jacob Everson comes, Mitch comes, and sometimes our managers come too as well. So it's fun.
So dominoes is a big game in Omaha.
It's huge. We get after it.
Wow, we may have to play sometime.
You'll love it.
I haven't played in years, but you came in first once this season. Maybe there's even more first place finishes to come. Ty-Shon Alexander, good luck against Butler on Friday night. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
The Jays welcome in Butler Friday night, FS1, 8:45 Eastern time. It is Creighton versus Cancer night, which is a huge event in Omaha, a total pink out, as it'll be the Dogs and the Jays. Creighton looking to get a series split with Butler, but again, that's a game where you've got Creighton with two conference wins, but at home, looking to get back at Butler. The Dogs with three. Who's going to separate themselves here? The race to nine wins. I'm not even putting it at 10. The race to nine is going to be a total gauntlet because everybody's going after each other. So why has Villanova been able to start 6-0 in conference play? They started just 2-2 overall. Of course, it's Eric Paschal and Phil Booth, but it goes beyond that. We got the perspective from the coach. Steve Lavin joins us all the way from Los Angeles, and some of his friends crashed the party too. We now get the coach's perspective. It's Lav from LA. Steve Lavin is joining us from the Fox Sports newsroom. We know this is some hardcore journalism from Coach Lav here on Shootaround. Steve, we are into the thick of things in the Big East, and the reigning national champion Villanova Wildcats are at the top. What do you attribute the 6-0 start to conference play to?
Well, I think number one, you've got to look at the leadership in Jay Wright, and there's a pattern year after year. Villanova demonstrates the ability to improve from their losses because they're willing to learn, to be honest with themselves in terms of deficiencies. They go back to work in practice after watching game film, and they address those deficiencies and create better basketball habits, and then obviously go out and continue to dominate Big East play. And we've seen this. It's year after year, so it's not a fluke. And then let's look at their math in terms of the analytics. Their three-point shooting right now, of all the major college programs, you look at the power conferences, they take 52% of their shots from the three-point line, and 40% of their overall points that are generated by Villanova are a result of that three-point line attack. And because they shoot the ball proficiently, they take care of the basketball in terms of controlling tempo and not turning the ball over. And they're always solid defensively. You put that all together, and it's why they're undefeated.
Let's stick with Phil Booth for a moment, because through the years, it's been Jalen Brunson, and last year's team had multiple different A-type playmakers. Ryan Archidiakono comes to mind as well. In what ways have you seen Booth become that A-type playmaking guard for Villanova?
Well, it's remarkable why people now associate Guard University with Villanova. Back in the day, people associated Guard University with Lute Olson's Arizona program because the number of outstanding guards that played for the Wildcats. But Josh Hart comes to mind. I feel as though Phil Booth is really channeling a Josh Hart. The numbers bear that out as well. Interestingly enough, if you just take conference play as a sampling, in those players' respective final seasons, whether it's Josh Hart, Archidiakono, even Jalen Brunson, Phil Booth's numbers to this point conference play are actually higher, doing better than any of those former Villanova greats. So even go back to Randy Foy. Right now, Mr. Booth is torching it from long range at 47% in conference play, has over 5 assists per game in conference play as well. And as we know in crunch time, he's dialed up the dagger threes, but it's his playmaking, his shot making, and his leadership on the floor. Truly an extension of Coach Jay Wright in terms of commanding and directing the Villanova attack.
The maestro, if you will, Phil Booth, hit a couple of those dagger threes in the Wildcats' first win at Hinkle Fieldhouse in their last three tries. But let's turn to the second-place team, but a higher-ranked team, the 12th-ranked Marquette Golden Eagles. Coach, we knew Marquette could score. You've always raved about their offensive ability. Why have they been able to turn the corner on defense?
Well, first, they have the personnel for the first time during Steve Wojciechowski's tenure at Marquette. The size, the length, the depth, and those are important factors. Even if you want to play defense and you slap the floor and you talk about it, at the end of it, you need strong personnel. And You build championship level play from the inside out. If you look at the history of basketball, with few exceptions, and there are some, championship level play is a result of dominating the paint. And Bill Russell, Elijah Wan, Shaquille O'Neal, George Mikan, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, in the history of basketball.
Keep naming them. How many more can you name?
Rob Stone is over to the left.
It's now a game. We're counting.
Yeah, he likes to keep me on my toes. He's always, you know, from the peanut gallery, giving me shots.
That's Rob Stone, folks.
I'll address Rob once we finish up this Skype.
You will address me right now, Coach Lavin.
He's so fired up.
You will talk to me right now.
Him and his friend are headed to Utah.
Easy,
and,
guys, easy.
This is what I have to work
on. Look what bowling did to Stoner. Look what bowling did to Rob.
Colgate and UConn.
It's fine.
What's
Relax.
Colgate's?
Raiders.
They're the Raiders.
Patriot. They're the Raiders. Man. Yeah, good soccer program.
Yeah. And I'm a Chapman Panther, and I'm here. I am double teamed by a Husky. And a
where are you, Coach? Panther. I can't see you.
We're in New York City.
Somebody bring Laugh back. Bring Laugh back to the show.
This is now the best. It's like the Californians. We've got Sonny peeking behind Lav, and Rob Stone has crashed the interview as well. This is epic.
Yeah, so much for the Edward R. Murrow or Tom Brokaw kind of news environment that we were trying to create here with the background of, you know, hard at work journalists and people helping us with our research. But back to Marquette, with the ambush aside now, they just have more balance. Theo John gives them a hard edge, some toughness, the broad shoulders, the size, even on offense, his ability to set screens, get some putbacks, do the dirty work for Marquette down low. But they're just better defensively, and they're more balanced offensively in terms of both an inside-outside attack. And as a result, they're knocking on the door and in the race for the Big East Championship.
Let's get your forecast in Queens. What's the forecast for St. John's at this point?
Well, we know their first five are as dynamic as any in the country, led by St. Pons, Shamori Pons. His ability to play make and shot make, as good as it gets. He seemed to have fought through some injuries and is in a better place now in terms of his health. But their question marks are the size, the lack of size, because Tariq Owens transferred to Texas Tech, Kasum Yakwe transferring to UConn. Those were some players on the front line that would have given St. John's a little more size, some resistance at the rim. And so when St. John's struggles, it's because their lack of depth and lack of a presence inside, much like Marquette in recent years. They didn't have that front line they now have. And so St. John's capable of making the NCAA tournament, making a run in the NCAA tournament with that small ball approach, electrifying athletes, four of their five can torch the nets from long distance. Marvin Clark has versatility, could take a game over both off the bounce as well as from long range, a very tough matchup. And Justin Simon, a two-way player, both defensively. He can influence the game positively as well as offensively with his driving ability. I'd like to see Simon posted up on occasion. I think sometimes he is a little too reliant on the jump shot, and I think he's at his best driving, also in the open court and getting on the glass for second shots. But yes, a dynamic team, and LJ Figueroa has had flashes of brilliance. But to win on the road in this league, it's so rugged. If you look at the history of the Big East, if you don't have a rugged front line, you're going to struggle, in particular on the road in the Big East. If you don't have a presence at both ends of the floor in the paint, it makes it tough.
You're a recruiter out everywhere in Los Angeles.
Absolutely.
I know you are. Late night LA scene, you're recruiting.
Well, you know what? Rob Stone makes sure that I get to bed early. He's been a real positive influence on me. Yeah. And, so that's been, you know, one of the real pluses. He's just really
grounded. Has he taught you bowling?
He hasn't yet, no, but that's something that down the line this spring we hope to get more time together so we can actually do some bowling.
Nice. You, Donnie, Stoner, everybody gets in on a group bowling alley.
Absolutely, yeah. I'll just be happy to get into the shoes. I'm not sure if I'll be able to do anything once I get into the shoes, but we'll go from there.
Coach Lavin, thanks for joining us to talk some Big East hoops.
All right, John, always a pleasure. Take care.
Thanks to Steve Lavin and Rob Stone and Donnie Marshall for joining us all the way from beautiful LA. You can find them on Fox Sports all season long. And Inside the Big East is every Sunday, looking at the different storylines across the conference. That's on FS1 and Fox throughout the season. There's a Fox doubleheader this weekend that features Georgetown and St. John's at noon, and then Seton Hall, Villanova. But let's open up the mailbag and take your questions. And the first question is on the Marquette Golden Eagles. How high is their ceiling? Well, here's my thought on the Golden Eagles. This is a team that in all likelihood could be in the top 10 come Monday. They need to show that their defense can travel. And I say that because Marquette has not allowed 70 points in their four Big East home games. They've held teams to under 70. But on the road thus far, they held Georgetown to 71, still a game that featured a lot of offense. But they gave up 89 to St. John's and Queens, and they allowed 104 to Creighton and Omaha. Steve Wojciechowski was on the Big East teleconference an hour ago, and he said, our defense has to travel. That's got to change. Theo John and Ed Morrow have added defense. Joseph Chartouni is a solid defender. But for Marquette, they need to show that they can put together what they've done at home on the road. They've only played four true road games. They're going to play half as many in the next week. They're at Xavier on Saturday on FS1. Then they're at Butler next week. If Marquette comes out of that swing 2-0, then I'll tell you what. The committee and everyone around the country is going to have this team as a team that could be on the two line, as high as the two line in the NCAA tournament. I think they're a four or five seed in the NCAAs, but they could be as high as the two or three if they keep on winning, but they need to show that they can travel. So that's what I make of Marquette. Next question comes from a Friar fan asking, what are the chances of Providence making the NCAA tournament? Well, that starts with A.J. Reeves' return. Providence, they're expecting him to be back. If not this weekend against DePaul, then for sure at Seton Hall next Wednesday. A.J. Reeves is going to return in the next game or two. So for the Friars, they are a team that's young and retooling because you have Duke Reeves, then you have Mekhi Ashton-Langford, who's just a sophomore. And the players that you do have that are veterans are in unfamiliar roles. But Nate Watson has picked it up. He scored 21 points in two of his last four games, hit some clutch free throws last night. For the Friars, they need Reeves back, and then they could put a run together. I'm never going to doubt Ed Cooley, and if Providence got to 10-8, if you get to 10-8 in this league, you're an NCAA tournament team in my mind. I think for the Friars, it'll take 10-8, maybe 9-9 and a Big East tournament run, but I'm not ruling it out. They could go to the tournament. Finally, tying in with Providence, Tom Zinzarella asks us, would DePaul jump into Tier 2 of the Big East if they won at Providence on Sunday? Here's the thing, Tom. When one win separates 3-10 in the conference, I'm not ready to separate teams into tiers. Travis Steele, the Xavier head coach, just said anybody can win on any given night. And that sounds cliche, but I think 3-10, anybody can win on any given night. Let's respect Villanova and Marquette. They're a combined 12-1. It's very hard to beat them. But 3-10, who knows? As we take a look at the weekend schedule, and I have my eyes on tomorrow night, 8:30 Eastern Time, FS1 will be shortly after that, that Butler visits Creighton. Really intriguing matchup. Can Marquette play on the road? Can their defense travel? They're taking on a Xavier team that struggled to score. Marquette needs to prove themselves away from home on Saturday afternoon at Cintas Center. DePaul Providence is big. Georgetown St. John's, those two matchups are teams that either have three or two conference wins. And then, Seton Hall has not won at Villanova in 25 years. They put that to the test on Sunday. That's around 2 Eastern time on Fox. That's a big game out at Villanova. The Wildcats, man, they have that duo. It's reload for Jay Wright, and his team has evolved tremendously. Villanova, Seton Hall renewing their rivalry in Philly on Sunday afternoon following Georgetown St. John's. Mullen Ewing will be live on Sunday. More info to come on that. Matt Schumacher, Shoe from Indy to New York. He'll be here in New York to host Shootaround on Sunday. Most times on this show, I come to you on a lighter note. We like to have fun here. That's what Shootaround's all about, and we love having you every week. We're on the Fox Sports app. We're on Big East Twitter. We love social media, and the great power of it is on display on this show every single Thursday with your numerous questions and comments about the league that you absolutely love and I love. That's why I'm with you every week and why I love this job. But I come to you with a thought. There's two prevalent things in our society, and one is social media, and it can be used for the good. But remember the decency that should come with that. Of course, it can give you an anonymous platform to fire out a tweet at anybody. But the other prevalent thing in our society is mental health. It's important. And while coaches will say that their 18 to 22-year-old players need to block out distractions, at the end of the day, they're 18 to 22-year-old kids. And it's human nature that we're all paying attention to what's on social media. It's important to remember that. It's important to remember that these are 18 to 22-year-old kids and that they have to get up on a morning after a crushing defeat to whoever in the Big East and go to an 8 to 10 a.m. physics lab or an 8 to 10 a.m. business class. They have to get up, and they're more crushed than you are about the loss or anybody watching the game. Remember the decency that should come with those types of comments. Your passion is overly infectious, and it's why we love being with you here on social media week in and week out. That passion can be channeled into something as good as a Saturday afternoon at Hinkle Fieldhouse or the Cintas Center or a Friday night at Madison Square Garden. Channel that passion and remember who you're rooting for. It does us. It does it for Shoot Around this week. We're back on Sunday. Matt Schumacher will be live from New York City as we get you loaded with a weekend of Big East basketball. The chaos has revved up and is in full form, and there's complete parity. There's a lack of answers. We'll try to find out those answers as the March to MSG rolls on. Enjoy your weekend.